Ladies and gentlemen, good evening to all of you. Big data, big issue, that's the problem of this this evening. I'm very curious, who has a Facebook account? Fingers please. Whoa, that's quite a lot. And who uses Twitter regularly? Okay, it's quite a lot. And who has a Albert Heijn bonus card? Whoa, that's almost everyone. And who has an ING card, you know, from the bank, the Dutch bank? Oh, that's interesting. Okay, that's good to know. Because those are all instruments for the big data analysts to get information about all of you. This evening we talk about the possibilities of big data, what can you do with big data files, and we talk about the advantages, the dangers, the ethical issues. We have two intriguing speakers for this theme. We have Dr. Duurt Hiemstra. He will explain the technical aspects, how does big data work, what is big data. He is an associate professor of database and search engine technology at the University of Twente, and he will explain how huge amounts of data on large cluster of commodity machines initiated by Google, Twitter, Facebook work. What kind of algorithms do they use to retrieve information? And Duurt also managed to get his hands on the all Twitter data. Maybe you read it in a newspaper. So beware what you're twittering this evening, because it will be analyzed by Duurt. That's the technical part of this this evening. Then we go to the reflection part with Dr. Johnny Hartz Surecker. He is an assistant professor of philosophy of technology at the Department of Philosophy at this university, and he will reflect upon philosophical and ethical issues related to big data, and he will especially reflect on the ING card issues. Before I give the floor to Duurt, I want to mention that Duurt and Johnny are both member of the Young Academy at the University of Twente, and that's a select group of young and promising researchers. There are a few others among the audience, so I want an applause for Duurt Hiemstra, the first speaker.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thanks very much for having me here, and it's really great to be here in the amphitheater. It's one of the most beautiful theaters, I think, that we have. So my name is Duurt Hiemstra. I'm an associate professor, search engine and database technology at the database group. And I would like to start my talk by defining big data and a bit giving you my view on what is big data, because big data is used by many, many people and organizations. Now, we're doing big data. So why are you doing big data, Duurt? For me, I would like, because it's there. That's why. Why are people climbing Mount Everest? There's no particular reason why. There's nothing there at the top, but people climb Mount Everest. So I just started to do this. We're doing lots of research on search engines and improving the quality of search engines. And in the end, you have to deal with lots of data. That's why we started to do big data. Well, climbing Mount Everest used to be like a big deal, but actually it's not a big deal anymore. Actually, there are traffic jams on Mount Everest. So this is 19 May 2012, and 234 people reached the top. And move over, I'm going to the top. So and with big data, it's very similar. Everyone can do big data these days. Just as everyone can do Mount Everest, if you have enough money, you go there. You don't need a lot of training. Just go there, and there are some people that will guide you to the top. And in the same way, everyone can do big data these days. So to give you an idea of the kind of algorithms that I think makes big data very interesting, I would like to give you an example of Hayes and Efros who presented a work on what they call scene occlusion. So you have a nice photograph, maybe of your family, and you want to remove some part of that, maybe your ex-spouse. So, how would you do that? Like, how would people in the audience do that? Photoshop, yes. So that would be my guess as well. So what I would do is in Photoshop, I would like carve out the roof. Here, in this case, I want to remove the roof, right? Because I like the scene with the lake and the little town. So I want to remove the roof, and then what? Sorry? Clone. Yeah. Yeah, you take a little bit of water and then you like put it everywhere, maybe. Yeah. So Hayes and Edwards wrote a little program that does this automatically. So you just you give your computer this, like remove this roof, and then they come up with this, which is way beyond my Photoshop skills. So the program decided, there should be some boats there. Yeah. So until their work, people had computers do exactly this. They try to infer what could have been there on the part of the image that was removed by like cloning parts and maybe by having some domain knowledge, like, well, at the top there's usually a sky which is blue, and at the bottom there might be grass or water or maybe just a road. And they had a very different approach. Actually, the algorithm is kind of stupid. Okay, they're good programmers, and they give it a big try. But what they did is they had a very big collection of photographs, and they checked one photograph at the other to see which one would fit the little part that was removed. And that one over there actually had the boats, and that fits kind of nicely. And if you write an algorithm like that, you just have to look what's at the borders, what matches well. And that's not rocket science. What maybe is rocket science is that you have to write the algorithm such that it can do this very quickly on maybe millions or tens of millions or billions of images. And that's what I did. So if you give this algorithm like 100,000 images, works not very well. Maybe a million, it starts to be guessing some right images one at a time. But if you give it tens or hundreds of millions of documents, you have a perfect scene occlusion system. And I think that's the power of big data. So if you manage to write computer algorithms that can handle lots and lots of data, you can get away with pretty stupid ideas and algorithms. The program versus the data. So when I was a student in computer science, I learned a lot about programming, and I got images like this. This is a slide from Peter Norvig. He is actually there at the bottom. There's a pretty cool paper that was written by Halevy, Norvig, and Pereira. They are all at Google, and it's called The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Data, and this is also one of the examples he takes. And he says something like, well, there's a lot of, the way we're teaching computer science now, there's a lot of things we learn about the program. But actually, the real value in applications and computer programs these days is not really in the program. If I would have to buy Facebook, I'm not really buying the Facebook application or program. It's nice. But what makes Facebook worth a lot of money is the data. And same for WhatsApp, for instance. WhatsApp is a very cool system. The algorithm is great. They can push lots of messages through their system. But you're actually buying the data. Okay, this is another quote that I like a lot. And it's to show that this idea is actually quite old. This is Frederick Jelinek, that was one of the people at IBM that made the first speech recognition systems. And they started out with people with lots of knowledge about what is speech. How are people speaking? And those knowledge was encoded by linguists in cooperation with computer scientists in their system. And he had this, so Johnny will talk about ethics, so I thought this is a nice quote that he can, like, it's not maybe the most ethical talk, but he said, whenever I fire a linguist, our system performance improves. Because when they replaced the knowledge of the linguists by knowledge that was driven by the data, their system improved. And it was in the 1980s, and especially for speech recognition, this data-driven approaches were very much more successful than the knowledge-based approaches. So this is actually one of his slides where he says they had a phonetic acoustic model based on the phonetics of the way words are pronounced, which by experts had an accuracy of about 35%, but estimated on the data in the 1980s already had an accuracy of 75%. And if you had a really stupid model that is based on the orthographic base form, basically on how it's written, not on how it's pronounced, based on the data, it would still outperform the phonetic models from the linguists. And so they started to build algorithms based on data. Rather stupid algorithms based on lots of data. That makes a very good speech recognition system. That's also why Siri made their, so the Apple made their Siri system open in beta. Maybe it's not perfect yet, but they gather all this data from you and they can use it to improve the system. So here's another of these guys from IBM. He said, there's no data like more data. So it doesn't really matter if the data is very clean, it's very nicely annotated. Any data about speech that you can put in your system will improve the system. So some of the data is very nicely annotated, but other data, like this, the data that maybe Apple is gathering with Siri from all of us, if we have an iPhone, it's also cool data. So even if data is a bit messy, that's okay. So my master thesis, I did my master thesis with Professor Francesca de Jong, and she told me, you try to build a machine translation system based on data. And I had a couple of colleagues that at that time said, that will never work. It's nice, you're busy for a while as a student. Will never work. But this is actually how these days Google Translate works. So you just feed it lots of sentences like this. The computer tries to find the alignments between the sentences. Like what word is the most probable translation of the other word. And the system is quite a simple and stupid system in the sense that any English word could be a translation of any Dutch word. And we only try to estimate probabilities based on these co-occurrences. And these are, I never did this, like talk about my master thesis for a long time. It's 1996. So this is the stuff we pulled off from a relatively small data source. It was based on United Nations documents that were translated in lots of languages. So something like local could be plaatselijke or also lokale or lokaal. Oh, right, I have one of these. So one study that I really like is this is a quote from Michel Abanco and Eric Brill from Microsoft. And they said more data is more important than better algorithms. This is already a bit what I there's a very interesting fact in this comment that they showed in this graph. So this is a system that they tested that does word sense disambiguation. So you give it a word like can, and the question is this a verb like I can do this, or is this a can that like can hold coffee? And they tested this on a lot of data, like a million words, but also on a lot more data. And it turns out that algorithms that work very well on like a million words might not be the algorithms that work very well on a billion words. In fact, it turns out that very stupid algorithms that are not working very well on small data, those are the algorithms that work very well on a lot of data. And there are a lot of researchers also at our university that constantly try to think of more smarter algorithms to do whatever thing. And this graph sort of suggests that we should stop doing this. We should have many more researchers that gather a lot of data instead of making better algorithms. Well, here's a similar study by people from Google from 2007. And they were testing here a language model for machine translation for the Google Translate. And so this model basically tries to model, for instance, English language. If you want to translate to English, it tries to model those sentences that are often occurring in English. And these models use some kind of a smoothing algorithm because you cannot possibly find all the possible English sentences in the real world, even not if you have big data. So the model sort of tries to guess sentences that it has never seen by some algorithms. And one of these algorithms that works very well in literature is called Nasr-Ney. It's this KN over here. Whoa! It's, well, how do you get there if you're not Google? It's a Nasr-Ney smoothing. And the other one they called Stupid Backoff. It's a very simple algorithm that basically says, if I haven't seen it, I'll just look at some smaller thing. And it turns out that on maybe, this is, I think, in millions of words, on 100 million words, the Stupid Backoff is really significantly worse. But if you give it a lot of data, and actually, when they progress in this graph, the data gets messier and messier. In the beginning, it's newspaper data, nicely formulated, not a lot of spelling errors. At the end, they throw a lot of web data at it. Lots of spelling errors, lots of weird things. But still, even with the messy data, the system improves. And as a surprise, as a surprise to me, the Stupid Backoff at some point outperforms the Nasr-Ney smoothing. So big data works, and big data works on really stupid algorithms. If you throw lots of data at it, the stupid algorithms outperform the smart algorithms. So yeah, so the question is, it already popped up, so how do we get there? If you're not Google, right? They had like, this is a million times a million. It's a million times, it's a billion, a trillion in English. I always have to think. Billion in Nederland. So how do we get there? So one of the things that we started to do is teach a course on basically on the technology and the frameworks and the infrastructure that Google uses to do these analysis. And the other thing that we did, we got a small data center ourselves. So for a couple of years now, we have a master course, which we now call Managing Big Data, which I did with Maarten Fokkinga and Robin Ali, where we have students working with Hadoop, which is an open source implementation of Google File System and of algorithms like MapReduce that Google uses to analyze a lot of data. And it's a cool course in the sense that it has all the core computer science topics. Like, we talk about file systems, big distributed file systems over lots and lots of machines. We talk about new storage models, like Google Bigtable, which is a kind of a database system that backs up Gmail and Google Maps, and nowadays also Search. We talk about new program paradigms. So one of the paradigms that we talk about is MapReduce, where programmers have to write their programs with two functions, map and reduce. And the nice thing about these functions is that we can easily parallelize them on lots and lots of machines. So as a programmer, I don't need to worry about which machine does what part of my data. I don't need to worry about machine failure, because if I have a cluster of 1,000 machines, one machine will break every day. So the program handles which data block is handled by what machine, and also it handles things like failure and will restart certain task of your big computation. And we did lots of other cool stuff. And this is our first cluster. Actually, there's one of the cluster buses. Yeah. So the proud owners. This cluster is actually sponsored by Yahoo. Because I guess Google already. Well, Yahoo was one of the main developers of Hadoop, which is this open source alternative for the Google infrastructure, which is closed, which we cannot access, obviously. So, I'm not really going to talk much more about the techniques that are underlying the analysis. One of these techniques is MapReduce, as I already said. There's also high-level programming languages that some of them were actually developed at Yahoo. One of them is called Pig Latin, so it's a sort of a simple version of SQL, which you can you'll easily analyze lots and lots of data that is nicely structured. And one of the things that we did in the early days was having a really big web crawl. It's about a billion documents in 2009. So already at that time, the Google index was bigger, but maybe only an order of magnitude bigger. And we had students using MapReduce implement sort of the basic infrastructure that underneath Google in, well, it's like the Google of 1998. So we did like PageRank. We extracted all the text from the anchor texts. The anchor texts are the text of hyperlinks where you click on. So if there's a text that says, well, Jewett has a funny hair and it points to my webpage, you can glue that to my site and you will find me if you search for funny hair. Actually, it was done to trick Balkan and to be found by funny body hair. And we built a simple system that then uses all these features to rank documents. And this was done as to participate in TREC, the Text Retrieval Conference, organized by the USA National Institute of Standards and Technology, which is like the USA TNO. And our system did pretty good. But the real cool thing was that with the infrastructure, we had actually the students that did most of this programming. And lots of these things were just done by brute force scanning this really big corpus of a billion documents, from document one till document billion. And that takes a while, obviously, so it might take maybe 10 hours to make this index, and maybe another 2 hours to do a couple of 100 or 1,000 queries. But our goal was to make to improve the quality of the search engine, and that's okay, right? You have a coffee, and if you improve the quality of your search engine, you can tell your engineers, and they can implement these algorithms in the production system, like in the real Google. So one of the cool things is if you have this infrastructure, if you're able to do this, you can you spend less time on coding. This whole infrastructure takes care of lots of things you don't want to worry about, like machines that fail. It's easy to include new information in your algorithms because you're scanning the data anyway from beginning to the end. And we could still do large experiments in real time. And there was a cluster of 15 machines. It's not really a big thing, like 1,000 machines. We have a bigger cluster now, so yeah. So having this infrastructure makes us able to do more experiments on more data, and more experiments means you easier find improvements of your algorithms, and yeah, a better system in the end is also more research papers, because it's nice to write research papers on things that don't work, but it's much nicer to write research papers on things that do work. So there's a paper about this that I wrote with Claudia Hauff, who's now at TU Delft. And we also made this software open source, so if you want to build your own Google, you could start here maybe and take it from there. So how much time do I have left? Okay. So, So I already had this graph there, right? The Google analysis, and I said, so how do we get there? So we were here in 2010, almost at the end of the graph. The Google paper was from 2007. So in a sense, we could be Google in about 3 to 4 years. If you have lots of data, right? If you want to climb Mount Everest, you can do this. If you have money to buy machines, and we're also doing experiments with the SARA, which is the supercomputer center in Amsterdam, you can actually do what Google did maybe 3 to 4 to 5 years ago, if you have the data. So one of the main problems is Google has a lot more data than just web documents, for instance, to improve their search. They have all this usage data. They know what you searched for, what you clicked on, how much time you spent on a web page. They have this whole advertisement networks. They know exactly what pages you have visited during your searches. So this data is usually not available for researchers like me, and some researchers have actually tried to make this available. There were some researchers by AOL that released their query log in 2006, which is a really cool query log, and actually we used it quite a lot in our research. But this turned out not to be a very good idea. So what they did is they replaced every thing that could identify a user by a random number, like I am number 54703 or something. And that should do the trick, right? And then anonymizing your data. Well, as it turned out, it does not, because people search for very personal stuff. I'm often doing an ego search just to see how I'm doing in Google, for instance. Or people search for things in their neighborhood. And it's not that hard to have, if you have a log like this, to identify people. And actually, some journalists of the New York Times showed that they did this for a couple of people, and they asked one of them if it was okay to sort of reveal who she was, which is Thelma Arnold. She is a user number, number 4417749 in this log. And she searched for numb fingers and 60 single men and maybe not things you really want to have out in the public. And what quickly happened after the journalist reported this in the New York Times, the researchers that made this log public were fired at AOL, and also the bosses were fired. Actually, three people were fired. Guess who? This was their paper. So there's a lot of really cool data out there, and this data makes big data analysis really, really interesting, also for researchers like me. But most of this data is very, very sensitive to like personal information, and anonymizing the data is not an option. So this is a result that we very recently published in the ACM Transactions on the Web. This is work done by Sergio Duarte, and here we looked at accidental clicks on adult content. And that's also definitely not data you would like to be out in the open. Actually, Sergio, one of the things that he researches is how children search and how we can improve children's search experiments and how we can protect children. And he also showed that for very young children, the probability of an accidental click on adult content is quite high. It's much higher than for all of us. So that's a very important topic. And the only thing that Sergio could do this research is actually go to the source. So Sergio spent a couple of months, 3 months at Yahoo Research to do data research like this. And this is, I think, also for us in the future, the way to go forward, to cooperate with Google, Yahoo, Microsoft, to do this analysis in their labs, and then write papers where maybe some of the the data we cannot report, but aggregate statistics like this are usually okay, and it doesn't harm anyone. And it learns us how to make, for instance, children more safe on the internet. Well, that's it, actually. I think that my time is up. So this is the next challenge we're doing. We're doing now 7 billion web pages. This is pages that are made available by Common Crawl, which is an American organization that has their mission to make lots of data available to anyone, so you can have the data. Most of the data is actually also there in Amsterdam at the SARA supercomputer infrastructure. And our students analyze this data now for the course. This is our data. And this is the final thing I would like to mention. This is sciencechallenges.nl. Some of the big data challenges that we do are run by students in something we call science challenges. And here's this Common Crawl challenge. So the thing is that we have students that do this as part of courses, but also in their own time. Because actually students came to me like, Jewett, lots of these courses are a bit dull. We want to do real cool stuff. So some of this is actually done by students. They don't get any credits for this. They do this in their own time. They build their own team. I really like that. So some of the students actually do my course, but also some they don't, and they learn from each other. And if anyone in the audience would like to analyze 7 billion web pages, then subscribe to Science Challenges, and we'll fix this for you. So that's it. These are some organizations I should thank, and yeah, thank you for listening.
Thank you, Jude. We go to Johnny in a few moments, but I'm very curious. You have access to all the Twitter data I told in my introduction.
Oh, right, yeah.
What are you going to do with how much data is it? How many megabytes or terabytes, whatever? And what are you going to do with it? Could you?
Yeah, I plan to mention that, but I failed to do that. So, no, so this is one of the other things that is basically go to the source. I have no clue how much data they have, to be honest. It's lots and lots of data. It's in the petabytes. We can access the data via Twitter engineers by giving them queries. And we can do basically whatever analysis we want on the data. We're not really getting all the data. That would be too much.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But do you already have some kind of idea what kind of analysis you want to do on the data?
So what we proposed is to do, one of the things we want to do is to analyze campaigns for early detection of cancer. There are lots of campaigns that have a very positive influence, basically because of Twitter and Facebook. Mm-hmm. People are much easier to persuade to discuss cancer and to also discuss, for instance, how you call it, early screening of cancer, like for instance, to persuade women to make a mammography of their breasts. There is a campaign that went viral last year. It's called Mamming. And women, they make a photograph of themselves and place their breast on some object. Because mammography is not very nice. Some of you will notice that it's not very nice to make this. And the women want to show, I'm positive about this. I'm doing this screening. Okay. And one of the things we want to do is to see what effect do these campaigns have, to see what things in the campaign work, what things don't work, and we also want to see if people are, much more positive about the screening before, after a campaign than mm-hmm. before the campaign. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, that's very interesting. We stop with you.
Yeah.
I invite Johnny. Thanks again, Jewett.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Johnny, would you like to take the headset, please?
Thank you. And thanks, George, for setting the stage. I do not sound too much like God here. Thanks for setting the stage and introducing a lot of this, George. We kind of have this sort of good cop, bad cop thing going. So since I'm an ethicist, I'm here to talk about all the dangers of big data. But I'm going to try not to be sort of the stereotypical ivory tower person. I'm going to try to see as concretely as possible how big data might change our lives and how it might change our individual lives, and in particular, how it might change our individual behavior. And when I started thinking about this entire notion of big data, the thing that struck me, as Jordan already mentioned as well, that in big data, you are nothing. Like, in big data, they're looking for, like, I have a hard time pronouncing this, but like schools of fish, like these fish swarms. You're not looking for Moby Dick. You're looking for these massive patterns of fish. So you as an individual, you don't mean anything in big data. So is there then any cost for individuals? And I think there is, because the individual comes before big data, and the individual also comes after big data. So part of the essence of big data is, first of all, is that, or at least the big data that I'm going to talk about, there are different types of big data, but the big data I'm going to talk about is the big data that is generated by individuals' actions. That behavior determines data. Then the algorithms themselves determine profiles. They're not looking for you as an individual again. They're looking for patterns. They're looking for types of people. They're looking for groups and profiles. That's what they want to find, patterns that recur across individuals. But then they make decisions on the basis of that big data, and that in turn affects individuals. So what I'm going to look at is sort of the individual on each side of big data here. Just to illustrate this a bit more, just to get us started here, I'm going to go a bit deeper into this, but just to get us started, let's look at one of the most talked about cases in the whole big data phenomenon. And many of you have heard about this already, so pardon me for repeating this. But as many of you know, one of the big controversies were surrounding Target, which is a retail chain in the US. And Target basically figured out quite early on that it's surprisingly easy to identify pregnant women. Of course, in real life, you got the stomach, but in data, you don't have the stomach. But in data, you have consumer behavior. So when you find out you're pregnant, that's when you panic and you start purchasing accordingly. Later into the pregnancy, you purchase different things. A month before the pregnancy, then you purchase completely different things. For instance, you stop buying cigarettes and alcohol at some point. So basically, it's very easy to look at that behavior and figure out, okay, this person, not only is this pregnant person pregnant, you can find out exactly what week or month of pregnancy this person is in. So there is an ethical issue already there, and I'm going to return to that issue at the very end, which is the issue of how can we make sure that companies are using this in a responsible manner. But before that, I want to look more explicitly at the individuals. And you have individuals on each side of this. So on the one hand is this case that has been a lot discussed, where actually Target did identify one of these pregnant women, and they started bombarding her with all kinds of advertisements about products that pregnant women would want. The only problem was that this woman was a teenager, and she also had a rabid dad, and he got kind of pissed, so he actually looked up consumer support or services, and he asked, hey, what are you doing? Why do you send my teenage daughter ads about pregnancy material? Are you trying to advocate pregnancy in high school? Because the dad didn't know that his daughter was pregnant. She hadn't told him yet. Target knew, the dad didn't. But Target told the dad, and just by that very fact, and I'm going to return to that, by that very fact, they took away the daughter's opportunity to present this to the father in her own way at her own time. So that's one side, and I'm going to return to a lot of this later on. But you also have individuals on the other side, even before any of this data is gathered. And this actually came in the wake of this sort of scandal happening, where this woman decided that, I'm going to try to do an experiment here. I am a tech-savvy, online all the time kind of person, but now I'm actually going to try to hide my pregnancy from advertisers. So she thought this was going to be an easy experiment. It turned out to be extremely difficult. First of all, she couldn't really use her credit cards anymore, so she had to purchase everything with cash. And whenever she went online to purchase something, she first had to buy gift cards, gift certificates, and then used them. Basically, what she found herself doing after a while was exactly the same strategies that criminals use when they launder money. Not only that, she also got all kinds of messages from families and friends. Yay, congratulations on her pregnancy. How did she respond? She immediately deleted the message. When they sent the message again, she unfriended them. Like, her entire family got really pissed at her because of this behavior. So she changed so much about her life just because she wanted to stay off the radar. So that's another side where the individuals are affected by big data. Just trying to stay out of big data or trying not to be identified incorrectly in big data, that in itself determines behavior. Now, to understand what's going on here, I want to look more closely at both sides of this. And I'm going to look at the first side first. And this is familiar to some of you who already have philosophy, but it might be unfamiliar to some others of you. So in order to understand this, we need to go back to the late 18th century, where Jeremy Bentham, one of the greatest philosophers ever to have lived, went to what is now Belarus and to visit his brother, Samuel Bentham. Samuel Bentham was at the time working for Prince Grigory Potemkin. He was an engineer, he did architecture and all kinds of things. And one of the things that Samuel Bentham was working on was this inspection house, as he called it. When Jeremy Bentham visited his brother, he remembered that, wasn't there like an announcement in some kind of newspaper back home where they wanted to have improved architecture for prisons to reduce the number of prison guards needed in the UK back then? So Jeremy started thinking more and more about this and realized that, hey, my brother is really onto something here. So Jeremy started writing letters back, trying to explain how this architecture is going to solve the problem. And the basic essence of the architecture is basically that all the cells in the prison are arranged in a circle, and in the middle there's a huge tower. And on the top of that tower, you place the guards so that the guards can look inside all the prison cells around. Now, good idea, right? We can reduce quite a lot of prison guards in that way. But no, that wasn't Bentham's point. Bentham spent page after page after page describing in minute detail how to design his tower in such a way that the guards can look out, but the prisoners cannot look inside the tower. In other words, the guards could constantly look at the prisoners and see what they were doing, but the prisoners never knew whether the guards were actually looking at them. And Bentham's ingenious idea was precisely that the mere fact that the prisoners believed they were being watched would in itself be enough. And this is, of course, something, as many of you know, Michel Foucault picked up and used as a metaphor for a lot of modern developments. And Foucault, as Frenchmen have a tendency to do, puts this in beautiful terms. So let me do some PowerPoint karaoke right now and just say some of his main issues here. The major effect of panopticon is to induce in the inmate a state of conscious and permanent visibility that assures the automatic functioning of power. In other words, there is no actual exercise of power going on. It's all in the mind of the prisoners. So, that the perfection of power should tend to render its actual exercise unnecessary. To achieve this, as he puts it so beautifully and so correctly, it is at once too much and too little that a prisoner should be constantly observed by an inspector. Too little, in the sense that it's not enough, because what is needed in addition is for the prisoners to believe, to know themselves that they are observed. And it's also too much, because you don't even need the guards at all. You just need to make the prisoners believe they're being watched, and they're going to behave in socially acceptable, conform ways. Now, this is the key reason why you might have nothing to hide at all, but you might still have something to fear from these privacy discussions that we've been having lately. The panopticon effect basically says, and this has been shown in several psychological studies in different kinds of domains, that the mere belief that somebody is watching you makes you act in socially acceptable ways, in conform ways, to put it bluntly, in boring ways. And you might remember yourself, if you've ever been sitting with your laptops, I see some of you got your laptops up now, paradoxically the ones on the back row, because it's not very cool to sit there with your laptop and write an email, is it, if somebody's watching over your shoulder? If somebody comes into the room and looks at you while you're writing an email, you just stop and everything becomes awkward. Just the fact that somebody watches you completely changes your behavior. And coming from Norway, I was promising myself not to shit on Norway this time, but This is just social democracy, normal Protestant, everybody behave the same kind of propaganda. And that's exactly what happens when we feel that we're being watched all the time, when we feel that the NSA is watching, when we feel that Facebook is watching, and so on. Now, this gets even worse if you add another, and again, well-documented psychological phenomena of group polarization. Because big data is increasingly used for recommendations, and you've all seen this if you use Netflix or Amazon or Spotify or anything like that. You get all this, you may also like this music, or a consumer who bought this also bought these items, and you get all these recommendations, and all of that is a result of big data and clever algorithms. But the problem is a phenomenon called group polarization, which basically says that when you're not subjected to opposite views and taste, your existing views and taste become entrenched, and often they become polarized and more and more and more extreme. So if you listen to music and you get these algorithm recommendations all the time, you tend to keep on listening to that same music. You tend to read the same stuff. You tend to look at the same movies. You tend to purchase the same things, all because the algorithm told you so. Now, this is a bit overstated, so let me just bring it a bit down, but at the same time, try to show how serious this is. So basically what we're talking about here are algorithms crawling through big data in order to determine what you listen to, what you read, what you watch, whom you connect with, what you purchase, even what you should vote in some of these voting sort of tutorials. So algorithms determine that, which is something we're okay with, but what if politicians had been determining that? If politicians had determined what you listen to, what you read, what you watch, whom you connect with, what you purchase, how you should vote, that's fascism. So we don't accept this when politicians do it, but we somehow do find it more okay when algorithms do it. There is a big difference here, but still, it's something really worth being concerned about. Why? Because diversity is the key to everything. Diversity is the reason I'm in the Netherlands now. Like, diversity in the Netherlands is the only place where you can walk around with a pink shirt and red pants and flowy hair and nobody even bothers. Like, if you did that in Norway, somebody would kick your ass. The fantastic diversity you have in the Netherlands, that's what creates an interesting society. And more specifically than that, diversity is necessary for innovation, democracy, and flourishing relationships. It's been shown again and again that the key to creativity lies in a wide breadth of knowledge, having knowledge from all kinds of disciplines, having listened to all kinds of music, read all kinds of different stuff. That's where creativity and innovation comes from. Democracy, there's a political scientist called Cass Sunstein, who's actually one of the advisors to Barack Obama, who's written this fantastic book called The Value of Dissent, where he basically argues convincingly that democracy without the freaks, democracy without the extreme people on the left and the right wings, is not a proper democracy. You need that diversity. And in order to have that diversity, you can't be afraid that somebody is judging you for what you read. You can't have that panopticon gaze on you. And nor can you have everything you do recommended to you by algorithms. And also flourishing relationships. Like, if you think about the people you love, I'm pretty sure there are two things that identify the people you love. One, you have something in common with them. Two, there are several things that are completely different, and that's what makes the other person interesting. That you have completely different interests. You have listened to different music, you have read different books, you have different input in the conversations. And again, that's the kind of diversity we need, which might be flattened by a lot of these big data practices. Now, those are some of the more abstract ivory tower things. So if you're feeling that this is, okay, theoretically this sounds a bit scary, are there any actual real impacts here? So let me make this much, much more concrete. Let me boil it down to me, actually. Imagine that I'm going to the bank to get a loan. And when you go to the bank to get a loan, you give away a lot of information. Voluntarily, of course, I got to give you information. I want a loan from you, so it's just fair. So imagine that I'm somehow, at some point, I get fed up with the neurotic existence of philosophy. So I decide to start my own company instead. So I give all this data. I want to have a company startup in a particular sector of IT. Let's call it 1349. I have no prior bankruptcy. I have a certain educational background. I live a certain place. I'm a certain gender, a certain age. That's not my real age, actually. I'm not going to give you that. Nobody noticed. Good. And then they get all this information, and that's when the big data kicks in. Because that's when they start finding patterns, finding relationships between this data and all the data you can find in databases about the number of the types of bankruptcies you've had in this sector for the last few years. Bankruptcies correlated by age, gender, ethnicity, education, relationships between income and gender and ethnicity, and all that kind of data. And they do a lot of mining and a lot of algorithmic searching through this, and they find, hey, this Johnny guy isn't half bad. He actually might deserve a loan. Great. So I get a score of 0.78 and loan accepted. Yay! I can start my business. Now let's change the variables a little bit and see what happens, or rather to see what could happen in the not too distant future. Let me add this one. In addition to these databases, let's say that you also connect a lot of this to my Facebook profile. And just to make clear that this is real, this has actually happened. There was a bank in the US where they had this loan programmer who actually made this algorithm that connected credit scores and bank records to Facebook to try to find patterns. And the sad thing was that he found patterns. He found patterns between music likes and your credit score and how good a loan candidate you are. In particular, he found that anybody who liked rap music had a lower credit score. They would more likely go bankrupt. So now suddenly, just by the pure fact that I was so stupid that I liked MC Hammer at some point, because I'm a nostalgic old fart, just because of that fact, I'm not getting a loan. Now things start getting a bit more serious. Let me show you a different example. What if they connect a lot of this to my purchase history? Exactly what ING wanted to do, to try to bring purchase history into the equation. Now you can actually see that my score has gone up. I'm at 0.84 now, loan accepted. But what on earth made actually my score go up? It's because I bought some of these. And it's another pattern they find through big data. The people who buy felt pads for the furniture so as not to scratch your wooden floor tend to be much better payers of their debts, much more careful economically. So just the fact that this is in my record now increases my likelihood of getting a loan. And of course, you see the problem here. I might have a carpet at home. I might not even need felt pads. And by that very fact, I might be discriminated against if we move further into this future. Okay, some sort of silly examples so far, but let me make this a bit more serious. Let me remove some of this. Let's go back to the original set of databases, and let's just make one slight change here, which might be a bit difficult for you to imagine, but please, for the sake of the argument, try to imagine that for present purposes, I'm actually African-American. I know it's a bit of a stretch. I was thinking about giving myself a black face on that picture, but the whole Swarte Piet discussion, I don't know. Now my score dropped to 0.48 just by the very fact that I'm African American. What is going on here? Well, what's going on is now as well is, and please bear with me for a while because this is not as bad as you might think, but the number of bankruptcies among African Americans, among blacks in the US, is quite much larger than the number of bankruptcies amongst whites. This means that blacks would have a much harder time of getting a loan once this is included in the whole set of data. Now, why do blacks, African Americans, why do they go bankrupt more often than whites? Is it because they are somehow intrinsically worse species? Of course not. It's because of racism. They actually looked at this on the number of types of bankruptcies, and this is one of the really weird things that's going on here. In the US, you have two different ways of filing for bankruptcy. There's a Chapter 11 and a Chapter 13. One is really cumbersome, and you never really get out of debt. And the other one is the more sort of convenient one, where you sort of get rid of all your debt, and you can start afresh and start your company anew again. Now, they checked with lawyers, and they gave them basically different names, sort of white-sounding names and black-sounding names. And whenever there was somebody they thought were black, they would recommend them to do a Chapter 13. When they were white, they would recommend them to do a Chapter 11. And a Chapter 13 looks much worse on the record. It makes you much more a permanently bad bank customer, purely because of the racism, the bias of these lawyers, of these accountants. And this is one of my key things. I started by talking about behavior in, behavior out. There's also bias in, bias out. So when bias goes into big data, bias also comes out of big data. And just to make this even more clear, of course, during the financial crisis, a lot of these really greedy bastard banks, they were basically outed for having steered blacks towards really, really bad loans. They were the ones who got this subprime crap that they would never be able to get out of. Now, that racism feeds into the big data, and now that big data is used for racist purposes again. So that's the big problem with big data here. In other words, we're living in a future of computer says no. If you haven't seen this TV series Little Britain, they have a recurring sketch where basically you have this woman, whenever the customer asks, she looks at the computer, blah, 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 computer says no, for whatever kind of query. And that's the future we're heading towards. Because the decisions are now made on the basis of which big data pattern you belong to. And it's created from merging separately and sort of voluntarily collected information as well, often combined with all kinds of statistical population data, and you are now a customer of that type. This type tends to go bankrupt more often than that type, ergo, you're not getting a loan as an individual. That's where the problem is. And there are tons of these kinds of biases that might affect you. I mentioned some of them already. There are all kinds of spurious correlation. For instance, if you give up your mobile number rather than your home phone number, you are seen as less trustworthy in many of these patterns. That might sound old-fashioned, you think, but yeah, a lot of this big data is old-fashioned. It's been gathered since the certainly since the late 2000s. So a lot of that is outdated already. So back to a time where a home phone meant something, that's still present in a lot of this data. You get the dubious inferences as well, like having had several jobs in a short amount of time it somehow lumps you into this category of people who have a lack of dedication, people who do not sort of fulfill their commitments and so on. And then you have, I mentioned these lawyers, I mentioned blacks being given these horrible loans, but also just workplace racism, that in itself. Certain groups have a harder time of getting a job, which means that they are worse customers, they're less rich, and because of that, they have a lesser chance of getting a loan. So again, this tends to entrench the status quo biases that we have. And then there are also these weird complete unknowns. For instance, they've looked at a lot of big data and figured out that if you want to buy a second-hand car, you have to buy an orange car. Orange cars are by far superior to any other color. Much more purple and red are the worst ones. If you've got a purple or red car, be worried. But I don't know why orange cars are better second-hand cars than others. It might be because they're more visible in traffic. It might be because people who like orange are more better drivers. We don't know. It's just a correlation and doesn't matter. As long as that correlation is there, it might still be used against you. In the sense that you might actually apply for the loan of a purple car, and you are going to be refused that loan because of the color of your car. Like, that's the kind of insanity we can get if you go too far down this road. And the thing that really upsets me, like, there's... I usually try to be careful when I teach, but as some of my students who are here know, there's nothing I hate more than racism, and I will bash on racists all day if I have to. And that's my big problem with a lot of this, is that it's blatant racism. Like, if humans refused you a loan because you're black, that's racism. But now, computer says no, I'm not saying no, computer says no, not up to me. It's actually an advantage for the companies that they don't understand the algorithms, which they often don't do, because then they can make these kinds of discriminatory decisions without themselves being sort of explicit racist, which is another fundamental problem here. So what can we do? Let me try to get to the constructive part. I have no idea how much time I have left. Oh, wow, cool. I've been saving a lot of digressions up until now, so that's quite amazing. So what can we do about this? Well, I want to address different groups of people. First of all, big data harvesters. To a large degree, researchers. Not necessarily when you get the data handed to you, but certainly when you start collecting a lot of data. Are there ways to make that data less of a ticking bomb? And there are. And the way to do that is more particularly to safeguard it through architecture rather than policies. Just to give you a quick example of this, like if you have a database of a ton of information, you can have databases that range from being identified, the privacy stage zero, and databases that are entirely anonymous. And a lot of that depends on whether you have unique identifiers across databases. If you have that, you pretty much only need three data points to indicate and find an individual. Exactly as this AOL example that George mentioned. The fact that she had a dog that had to pee everywhere, that in itself was a data point that led them straight to her. So when you have that, the only way to protect the data is by policy. You need to have contracts. You need to make people promise they're not going to use this data for something bad. You need to have reprimands if somebody does something bad. You need to have authorization levels, access keys, all of that kind of policy stuff. If you anonymize the data in a particular way, you don't need that. You can entrench privacy in the architecture itself. Just let me make this much more concrete if it's a bit too vague. This is a very simple algorithm just called K-anonymity. And basically what you do in that kind of algorithm, you have an algorithm that basically traverses your entire database and makes sure that whatever the combination of variables, at least K amount of hits are being found. So you see in the table on the right, you have four anonymity, because no matter what combination of variables you have at least four individuals. And the higher the K, if you have 12 anonymity, you will always find at least 12. The higher the K, the less you need to protect this. So once you have this, you don't need policies anymore. The anonymity is in the database. You don't need to protect it anymore. And very often for big data purposes, you can do this. You don't need these really narrow variables. You can add some garbage here and there, even things out, round things up and down, and by doing that, you secure the database without really losing the research usage of it. Now, social scientists and statisticians, if there are any in the audience, do more research on how to find and adjust and weed out these biases in big data. Now, in today's world, and if you know how the European Union works, there's nothing more sexy than big data right now. As I promise you, if you put together a good research proposal supposed to find biases and remove biases in big data, you're going to get your money. So just get on that. I know that some people at this university has actually worked on that already, but we need much more work, especially to get these sort of more sort of human biases out of the data, not just the noise. Now, what about us? What about the rest of us? Well, we are the 99%, and more particularly, back to behavior again, our behavior is the 99%. And this brings me back to this whole issue of ING. And I'm sure everybody here has heard about this now, that ING wanted to sell their customers' data to third-party advertisers. They tried to claim that, oh, no, that's not really what we're doing, but nobody believed them, and it doesn't really matter anyway. Because just the fact that they wanted to open that door, just the fact that they wanted to go down that path, was enough that people got pissed. And that's exactly what we need to do. Like, I'm not the kind of ethicist who wants to ask you to be really paranoid about your privacy, like this pregnant woman who tried to stay off the grid. That's just too exhausting. We've gone too far. We're too much in the information society to even try that. So what do we have to do? Well, we certainly need to stand up and shout when things go too far. Like the CCTV camera on the Automarkt, it actually helps against crime. I don't mind that at all. You can have my privacy at the Automarkt. I don't really care. But once you start looking at my purchase history and you start mixing that with an institution that is supposed to decide whether I get a loan or not, that's when we need to stand up and shout. That the companies are deadly afraid of us. And when ING did this, they got, even in Netherlands where Twitter isn't really that big, you got several thousands of tweets every hour throughout that day. And you can see sort of the types of terms that were being used, like fail and so on. People were rabid, and ING, I think it took them 3 or 4 days, and they basically, somebody got their full air scolded in one meeting, saying, you idiot, you proposed this, we're going to stop this now, and they did, because 99% stood up. So that's one of the things we can do. Another thing to do, and this is again because I don't really want to be seen as an old fart and only as the bad cop, what you have to do is embrace and endorse the really, really fantastic big data projects out there. And this is one of my absolute favorites. This is a big game called Play to Cure, Genes in Space. If you have an Android phone or an iPhone right now, you can download it for free immediately. It's basically a game where you drive the spaceship and you have to sort of find this target way off in the distance. But actually what you're doing when you drive your spaceship is that you are driving down enormous data sets of DNA data. The kind of data sets that the researchers can't go through in any reasonable amount of time. The kind of data sets that aren't really well structured for algorithms to go through it either. You need human eyeballs. So they basically place it in the game, and just by finding those objects and making the right turns and so on in the game, you're feeding all that data back to the researchers, and you help cure cancer while you're playing a relatively decent game. Now this is the way to go. This is good use of big data. And finally, and this is just, again, like I said, I'm not this kind of extremist who wants you to stay off the grid and start growing potatoes on your own and have a windmill on your roof and not be connected to anything. But be a bit aware and think a little bit. So your behavior feeds big data and the corresponding algorithms. So at the very minimum, ask yourself, is it worth it? Is my personal data worth it for this thing I'm doing right now? And I actually think in some cases it is worth it. Google, I know some of you don't like Google, but Google has literally saved my life on numerous occasions. If it hadn't been for Google Maps, I would just be lost somewhere right now. Like, I wouldn't be here. I would be lost in the slum of Barcelona somewhere. And I'm probably sold, and yeah, God knows what would have happened. They have saved my life. I think it's okay to give you a little bit of my personal data, certainly whatever you need in order to find my GPS location and all of that. So in those cases, maybe we shouldn't be too paranoid. But then, some people seem not to think about this at all, and especially on Facebook. And I've seen several people do this kind of stuff, if you can make it up, make it out. This is a political spectrum quiz on Facebook, which basically ask you very personal questions about your political leanings, about all kinds of ideological views and political views, economical views, and so on and so on. Not only do they get all that information about you, at the same time, let's request for permission because people click accept without reading anyway. So at the same time, they can access all your basic information, including name, profile picture, gender, networks, user ID, list of friends, and any other information I've shared with everyone. They can access my data at any time. My likes, my music, my TV, my movies, my books, my quotes, everything. I've seen so many of my friends willingly do this. For what purpose? To make a post on your Facebook wall. Is that really worth it? It's not. So, in other words, don't panic too much, but stand up and shout when it goes too far, and don't sell yourself too cheaply. And those are my most normative conclusions for today.
Thank you, Johnny, very much. Jules, would you please come? I have one mic for you. I think it works, yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Johnny, the last case you described, maybe there are some people in the audience who also clicked and to get a Facebook posted. Is there a way back when you're in the system? Is it when you did it and you listened to your talk and, that's the most stupid thing I could have done. Can they go back? No. Okay.
No, it's actually, you don't want me to digress about this. In the Talmud, that's a promising start, isn't it? In the Talmud, actually, there's a commandment that says, if you have a penitent man, thou shalt never remind him of his past. This is one of the most basic Jewish commandments, that if you've done something wrong in your past, you are allowed to reinvent yourself. You're allowed to find a new identity. You are now to regret that and move on and become a different person.
Mm-hmm.
And now, I want to use this term digital scars. When you have these digital scars, it's really hard to get away from that.
Mm-hmm.
And especially when the banks get a hold of it and use it for your credit score.
Mm-hmm.
And it is hard to get out of.
Okay.
digital scars. That's a nice term. Stuart, I start with you, and then we come to the audience. How careful are you in staying off the grid, staying off the radar? What did you think of Johnny's?
Maybe not careful enough.
Yeah. Me neither, really.
Please tell us what. Why not?
No, I think Johnny is right. There is if you're really sort of paranoid about this, and you're stopping your Facebook account and your Twitter account, and you just stop being online, you just miss out on lots of fun in life as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Are there people with digital scars in the room? Maybe it's difficult. Or who did something they regret?
We already know this. So.
And otherwise, George will find out by analyzing the tweets. There's place for questions, comments, debates on this topic. How can you find out how stupid you have been on the internet, Johnny?
That's a good question. Well, you can kind of see it when you browse the internet. Like, if you look at the ads on the next coming up next to you when you browse Google or when you go through Facebook or whatever, those ads tell you a lot about what people know about you. I wanted to make an example here now, but that could just embarrass you, so I don't want to do that. But imagine some weird kinds of ads, and suddenly you are suddenly in the need of this. What? Why on earth do they think I'm this person now? Like, when you start seeing a lot of that, that's a big sign that you've done something not stupid necessarily, but something that doesn't necessarily cohere with your identity.
Mm-hmm. But one thing I wrote down, what you told us, that there is a difference in typing in your mobile phone number or your home number. Are you aware of it when you're booking a flight or something like that?
No.
To Barcelona. Are you...
No, exactly. And actually, maybe that's the responsibility of researchers, especially people like George, to be much more open about the kinds of algorithms they use. And it's an issue of science communication, perhaps, to make people understand a bit more about how these algorithms work, how big data work, and so on. Because especially with these kinds of buzzwords, all kinds of myths start occurring as well, so we don't really know what's fact or fiction anymore. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I think there's an education component to that, which is very important.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, please. If I repeat a question,
that's a problem that you don't, again, I'm really being the bad guy here, so I'm exaggerating a bit now, but the problem is that you don't never really know how your patterns are going to be interpreted. They have this one big data app that actually predicts when you're going to be depressed. And it's meant for diabetes patients in particular, because they realized that when diabetes patients went into depressions, they stopped taking their medicines. So they made this app that basically monitored you for months and months and months and months and months, and at some point they started finding patterns that indicated that this might indicate that you are actually being depressed right now. One of those indicators were precisely that you didn't go online, that you didn't leave the house, and all those kinds of things. So in other words, in a big data world, mm-hmm. you trying to stay off the grid might be interpreted as you being deeply depressed. So mm-hmm. I'm exaggerating a bit, but the problem is that you never really know how it might be interpreted.
Okay, yeah, that's intriguing.
So one thing you could do is like install ad blockers or install things that make sure that search engines cannot track the pages that you visit. So there are simple tools that you could install on your computer to make you a little bit less visible on the internet.
Also gives information. You're a bit paranoia or not?
So. And Johnny is right, because the algorithms that we develop are like black boxes, and they learn patterns in a way. I talked about stupid algorithms, and in a sense they are stupid, in the fact that if you feed garbage in, or if you feed racism in, racism comes out. Mm-hmm. That's definitely mm-hmm. the case.
Yeah, it's really worrisome. Yes, please. If you install an ad blocker,
And also there's bad and good and bad tracking. Actually, the Electronic Frontier Foundation just a couple of days ago released this privacy blocker thingy, which basically blocks everything that's horrendous, everything that's completely blatantly not respecting privacy. So no, I don't think you can get entirely away from it, but if you get some of them, they will at least take the worst ones, the ones that are really looking to find patterns that they can exploit about you. And those are the bad ones, and not all tracking is bad, really. That's exactly the problem.
Could you repeat the question?
So what about the people who don't give access to their Facebook or people who have their privacy settings correct? And absolutely true. So this guy, this lone individual who did this algorithm for this bank, for most cases he couldn't find their music likes because most people had set privacy settings for that. Which means that this really affects the people who don't understand privacy settings. Those are the vulnerable ones. Mm-hmm. So he got it for an alarmingly large number of clients. And it's again, why those people and not others? It's because of a knowledge gap. Partly a generational gap, but partly just a knowledge gap. Like the tech-savvy people in the world, they can navigate cyberspace much better than the tech-stupid people. I'm not going to mention examples, but yeah, you catch my drift. So it basically hits a vulnerable group, which makes this even more discriminatory in some sense.
Sorry? Oh, you can cheat the system.
Yeah. So don't like rap, in other words, that's the key thing.
Okay. Yes, please. Questions about the ING card. Now 99% stands up, don't do it, but in a few months it might diminish and they will do it.
Yeah.
That, don't you think? Yeah.
If you look at the graphs of privacy concerns, it just goes down every year. People get less and less concerned about privacy. Mm-hmm. For good and bad, but yes, you're absolutely right, and that's why we need sort of these kinds of events. That's why we need to. Everybody in this room is just fed up with privacy by now, I'm pretty sure. But we can't stop talking about it because the moment we stop talking about it, then it's become so much easier to go down that path.
Mm-hmm. But what do you think the future will look like within 10 years? What? Are you still with ING, or doesn't it matter anymore? Because all banks give your information to commercial parties. What do you think?
Well, maybe George can support this or not afterwards, but just one thing that I'm thinking, that for many developments that are being sort of initiated by governments, by companies, mm-hmm. for profit maximizing purposes, often you get a reaction against that. So you get really good hackers on the other side trying to counteract that kind of development. Mm-hmm. And you do have some tools like that. For instance, you have a Firefox add-in that whenever you search for something on Google, it bombards Google at the same time with 1,000 additional queries just to camouflage your real query in just this big ocean of queries. And so I think if this goes much farther, I think the whole sort of anonymous crew is going to get on this and try to find some kind of countermeasures. Mm-hmm. Just look at Tor, the onion routing and all that. Those are measures against this development. Bitcoin is a reaction against this development. So you see these reactions all the time. And so I think maybe that's why it makes it hard to look into the future, because we don't really know how that battle works out. But maybe George has a better prediction.
Yeah, George, please.
Yeah, no, I like your suggestions, and there's definitely also maybe as university we are obliged maybe to do more research in this direction. For instance, there are definitely chances, for instance, to make distributed versions of Facebook where no one earns, maybe not Facebook, but a social network, but everyone owns a little part of it, similar to, for instance, Bitcoin. Where sort of no one owns the coin, but it is there. So there are technical solutions to this, and yeah, I'm a technical guy, so I'd like to think of technical solutions. But maybe there are also like more social solutions or ways that people can change their behavior, mm-hmm. which is harder because I have a son of 12, and I sometimes try to educate him. Like, are you sure you want to use your real name here? And he knows about, but he's sort of, the internet is, it's there when he was born and it's always there. So, mm-hmm. yeah, it's,
okay.
I think, I guess he will be less worried about privacy when he's a grown up.
Yeah, okay, I might imagine. And one thing about standing up, ING was very clear, everyone said, well, it's not possible. But the racism things you said with the banking, that's much more particular. How do people stand up against that? I think that's very complicated to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, one thing is to just advertise it. So when you are So this story is like the story with Target, stories with bank, kind of discriminatory practices. Mm-hmm. A lot of the stories come from people basically writing blog posts about what happened to me at the bank today, mm-hmm. what's really going on here. And then you have other people contributing with different kinds of theories, some of them in conspiracy land. Mm-hmm. But still, you get sort of this whole crowd thinking about what could have happened here. So it's a lot about it is just publicizing stories and and basically showing the bad people, the bad wolves for the bad wolves.
I think that is actually very hard. So when we did some research about trying to guess from Twitter someone's gender, is it a man or a woman? Mm-hmm. And we see that things are going wrong if I'm sorry to say this, but if you're my colleague Claudia Hauff, who was there on the slide, she talks a lot about computer science and technology, and the system thinks she's a man. Why? Because the system is a well, it's very basically prejudiced in a sense, because
Okay. Yeah, please. Questions about the energy consumption of Google, the Google Parks, you mean?
So I think someone at Stanford, which is also where Google comes from, he estimated the amount of energy for one query to be a cup of tea, heating a cup of tea. And then Google reacted to that by saying it's much less, and they reacted to it. I think they might not be very much off. So. Yeah, so trying to trick the system by sending lots of queries to Google that's not very, very nice.
If I may add to that, I actually completely agree with you. My first ever computer ethics conference, I was a young master's student and I was shit nervous, and I raised my hand because somebody presented this idea in one of those keynotes. And they presented this idea of bombarding Google with queries, and they said, this is a victory for privacy. So I raised my hand and I said, well, is this really warranted? Like, have Google really treated you that badly? Because when we talk about loyalty, in most cases, we are loyal and we trust people who haven't. They turn out to be trustworthy for a long time. They've been consistently good people to us. And Google, in my view, has been consistently good. Like I said, they've saved my life several times. So if that's the case, and they have a decent record, like, should you really punish them by doing that? You're warranted to do that. It's an evil company. I'm not going to mention things. But if it's an evil company, certainly. But for things like Google, I agree with you. I think it's problematic to sort of betray that behavior. Like, they behave well, we behave well. They behave badly, we start behaving badly. I agree with you in many ways. Yeah. The entire audience turned on me and said, "Hey, boo!" by the way, when I said that in that lecture. So it's not popular.
Thank you. Yes, please? Personal data is worth a lot, and will it be more? Well, I think more in the future? Can you use it?
I think one problem is, especially as we both have been talking about, that as an individual, you're not really worth anything. So this is a new existentialism. This is digital existentialism. It smacks a bit of prostitution in my ears. There have actually been some efforts, like in Second Life. A lot of people started earning money by filling out surveys and getting money for that, by sort of selling their data that way. But it quickly turned out that this is not, first of all, not enough people are willing to do it. Not a lot of people are going to be truthful, because if you're selling your data, who knows really whether you fabricated enough? They're much more interested in your actual daily sort of organic behavior and your sort of subconscious behavior even.
The question is it new big data? Because in the 1800 went to the bank, they also looked at you, what type of clothes you had, kind of skin color, the way you talked. Is it basically new?
I think it is in many ways. There's this Norwegian philosopher called John Elster who has this beautiful phrase, which is the civilizing force of hypocrisy. It's one of my favorite phrases. It basically means that when you're in a situation where you can be hypocritical, just by that very fact, you start being civilized. Like, if you have a favorite student, you start grading that student really objectively. And that's the kind of stuff that ideally we get in banks as well, certainly when we are informed, not back in the dark ages, of course, but now in modern society, even if a bank, and many of us have sort of these biases and sort of different kinds of prejudices we're not even aware of. But when you're in a situation making a decision about somebody else's life, you might have an instinct somewhere about, I'm not sure about this person because it isn't this and that, but it's my job to be objective here. So you can sort of pull yourself back. Data algorithms can't really do that. So I see that as one of the biggest differences. And then you can sort of blame the data for making the decision. So nobody's making a racist decision here. It's just big data patterns.
Yeah. Computer says no. Yeah. Okay. Last question, please. Yeah. Should there be laws for algorithms?
In my view, regulation never works. Laws never work. Like whatever, and that's especially with big data, because it's a black box, as Jordan's been talking about as well. Like it's so easy to camouflage your algorithm. Like nobody's going to look inside the actual source code that a bank is using to make sure they're not looking at these and these database fields. And even if somebody were, they're going to have, just like in the olden days when you had the real accountancy book and the fake accountancy book, now you can have the real algorithm and the fake algorithm. Exactly. You need a kind of sort of renegade journalism, this sort of citizen journalism to disclose algorithms that are faulty. So you can't do it by regulation. You have to do it by crowdsourcing, by eyeballs, by bringing it out there and revealing. I think maybe you can do that for isolated sectors. That for the bank sector, maybe you might be able to do that because the banking sector is heavily regulated anyway. But that's just one tiny piece of the problem. The big data is everywhere, of course. But I think maybe in some sectors you're right that you can do that.
Okay. Interesting. Unfortunately, we have to round up. If you have other questions, please come to Johnny and George afterwards. Thank you very much. It was an intriguing... It was an intriguing evening. George, just to mention one thing, more data is more important than better algorithms, and even with stupid algorithms, but with large data sets, you can do very interesting things. Johnny said, in big data, you're nothing, so you learned that. Stay off the radar, if possible. You explained the panopticon effect, which is very interesting. I think only the mere belief of being watched is changing our behavior. Group polarization you spoke about, and I think it's very important that big data might have influence diversity of our society, and that's one of the big issues. We might be flattened and put in one way and listening only to the one type of music or reading one type of books, and we might end up with a computer says no society, and that's no good. So thanks once again. And next week we have should have had a lecture about the internet, the physical appearance of the internet. So one question was about the energy consumption about net, but unfortunately Henk Steenman isn't able to come. He will come in November, and it will be in our Studium Generale Bestuur. So next week there's no program about the physical side of the internet. Thanks once again. Thank you.